apart from the sovereign debt crisis and possible sovereign defaults that a number of the more extremely challenged countries may suffer, the industrial world will be in fiscal consolidation mode no later than next year. We won't all be getting there with the same vigor and at the same time. And a country like the US, which is in dreadful fiscal shape, will be buffered against the market discipline that is prodding countries one at a time into fiscal tightening. They will be they're protected, buffered from that, both by the size of the economy, but mainly by the global reserve currency status of the dollar. But that buffer isn't infinitely thick. And if over the next 2 or 3 years, all that happens by your fiscal tightening in the US is the expiry of the Bush tax cuts on the upper quartile of the income distribution, then 3 years from now, the US will have lost its AAA rating and will be tested by the markets through rising long rates and widening sovereign spreads. There's no hiding place for anybody. At least no permanent hiding place for anybody. The immediate crisis, of course, has struck Greece, and that's appropriate, because Greece is in a class of its own as regards the awfulness of its fiscal financial situation. Yeah, it has the second highest, possibly the highest, because we can't yet be completely sure about the data, but certainly the second highest debt-to-GDP ratio, and a massive, recently revised up to 13.6% of GDP for 2009, general government deficit, much of which actually is structural. What is the contagion risk? Well, no other country in the European economic area is in truly dreadful economic shape the way Greece is. The others should all be able to manage, but they can encounter at any time, because of nervous markets, liquidity problems which could trigger a default if they can't be tided over. Right? Any country, Spain, Portugal, Ireland, Italy, could be locked out of the markets because the market shows a wobbly. And we don't have a facility to deal with that. So the opportunity was missed and the risk is there. The only entity that will be able to come in to tide over another sovereign at the speed at which markets are likely to act is the ECB. So I expect that the ECB, after swallowing once very deeply and agreeing to do one thing which it never would do, which is give differential access to the collateralized lending facilities to different sovereigns, I expect that Greece, in due course, will not just swallow, but hold its nose and engage in the sort of Euro-style quantitative easing, buying sovereign debt outright. I see no other way of preventing a liquidity crisis, which will occur almost surely for one of the other sovereigns from turning into a solvency crisis.
The restructuring, which you would hope would be orderly, which you think is coming in Greece, you think will come when?
Well, they need to have enough time to prepare the Greek banks, which can be done quite quickly, and the other European banks that have this highly concentrated exposure to Greece for the write-down in the sovereign debt. And that will, I think, should take, well, us through most of through this year into 2011. I doubt whether they wait until 2012, because that gets us too close to the end of the availability of the finance. Right? You want to do it while Greece can still fund itself at the concessional window that has been created. So probably 2011 sometime, that's the most likely date.
And the size of the haircut?
But if they did it today, this is a straight bargaining problem, right? Once you decided, to lose your virtue, right? For Greece's point of view, they want to go for the biggest possible haircut they can get. Because the loss of reputation of basically having defaulted, even if not in a legal sense, then, a voluntary default, it's like somebody coming up to you holding a gun to your head and saying, give me your money, then you voluntarily hand over the money, right? But it's subject to the gun being at your head. And that's voluntary restructuring is voluntary very much in the army sense. I need three volunteers, you, and you. So the reputational loss will be there. And they have the 40 incentives to go for the biggest possible cut, in principle, a write-off.
Sure.
Right? Now, what can they get away with? I think it's hard for the European partners to agree to anything that would put the Greek debt-to-GDP ratio below the average of the rest of the of euro area. So that means if you were to do it today, you'd get a 30% write-off, because that would bring Greece down from 120-ish to about 79, 80, which is the euro area average. And but if it were to done towards the end of the three-year period, as the Greek debt-to-GDP ratio goes to 150 and rises relative to euro average, I think it will be more like 40%.
So all the more reason to try and do it within the next 12 months rather than...
Yeah, and in fact, if, they, if the European economic area governments weren't such wimps, they would have done it right away, have done it up front, and say, OK, we have the choice, you know, we have to write down Greece, that means we have to bail out our banks, right? Okay, do it. And they're going to do that anyway, but they're going to do it in a way that is not politically embarrassing and doesn't have to be done before the by-election in North Rhine-Westphalia and all that kind of stuff. It is a, it's been a disgraceful episode for European heads of state, especially in Germany, for the narrow-minded parochialism that has been displayed in a way that really endangers not just the euro area, but the whole European Union. I think it's quite extraordinary. Now, it is my expectation, however, that we will get the European Monetary Fund in a not too distant future, or something like it, right? This mutual insurance mechanism. And that it will not just come with bags of money, enough to follow the power doctrine of, you know, overwhelming force, but also with the ability to punish, including the willingness to turn a to put a country into painful sovereign restructuring should be necessary. So it is a, the one of the this European Monetary Fund would have share with the IMF the ability to organize sovereign restructurings.
And you think that would be palatable to German political opinion?
Oh yes.
If, but if would, you got they, both sides,
they would.
Of
they, oh, if I'm
got saying, both
if
sides,
the alternative is open-ended financing or deficit,
right.
Yes. And it can be done without the treaty revision. This is the good news. It can be done under enhanced cooperation. You just get the 16 Eurozone members to set up this thing. And as long as it doesn't violate any of the existing rules of the Euro system, which I don't think it does, of the EU in the treaties, which I don't think it does, that this would work.
There's the other elephant in the room, as there always is, which is China. Not only holds so much the American debt, but sustains spectacular growth, as you say. Danger of a bubble. A, what do you, what's your forecast for China, and how vulnerable is it to the bubble bursting? And if that were to happen, how does that impact on what we're talking about this morning?
Chinese growth is clearly in the irrational exuberance phase. It's well into double digits, and it's driven by you know, credit growth and the tail end of a fiscal stimulus, which were, the, I think, entirely appropriate Chinese Keynesian response to this, to the fallout for China of the financial collapse in the West. Right? But they have not reversed their massive credit injection, even when growth was restored, and growth is now running above capacity. And credit growth and asset price behavior suggests that there's, at the very least, booms on the way, and selectively already in isolated pockets so far of the real estate market, evidence of bubbles. This will, can go on, as we know, housing bubbles can go on for decades, but these in most emerging markets, these things move in very fast motion. And I don't think the policy authorities are likely to slam on the brakes with effective instruments in, to prevent this. So we all have the full sequence of boom, bubble, and bust in real estate markets and also in the stock markets in China. Why aren't the authorities going to respond appropriately? Well, there are a number of reasons for that. First, the inexperience in this matter. Right? They haven't seen too many asset boom bubbles and busts. They're a new capitalist economy, so they're not experienced. So mistakes are easy. Second, they're in election mode, right? Seven of the nine supremos will turn over in, well, just over 2 years from now, late to 12, yep. early to 13. And that means that both the seven incumbents that are retiring to make way for the fourth generation will be jockeying for position to retain power post-retirement, and the new second tier candidate leadership will be jockeying for position. And you don't increase your chances of being elected to the highest office or of retaining sort of post-retirement power and influence if you run against the boom and the bubble. We know that in this country, it's a, so I think there will be a massive display of timidity and the determined use of ineffective instruments, the way we are seeing now in the reserve ratio requirements. Where are the interest rate increases, right? Where is the appreciation of the renminbi? Where are the constraints on first mortgages, right? I mean, they have constraints on second and third mortgages. Well, no good luck. But this is, it is just, it's classic, you know, let's hope it lasts until early 2013 and behavior.